Now, we've seen how females may prefer males who have more resources that they can then convert into more offspring for themselves, or they may prefer males with superior genes so that they then have healthier offspring or more likely to have offspring that will survive. But there's a third way that females might choose their mates that is, in fact, the most controversial aspect of sexual selection. This is an idea that comes from Darwin himself. And he said that, you know, females may prefer males simply because they're attractive. Attractiveness may be an end unto itself. Now, to get used to this idea, let's take a brief digression to the depths of animal behavior. And I just want to tell you a bit about a study that was done by a very famous biologist in the 1940s and 1950s, a man named Conrad Lawrence. And he found that animals can be attracted to certain stimuli, okay? And the brighter or the larger the stimulus, the more attractive it can be. So we all like shiny things, okay? And for each species kind of has its own shiny things that they happen to like. This particular picture is just that newborn geese, newly hatched geese, will follow an organism that walks away from the nest. So the first thing they see, they'll follow. And it doesn't even have to be a goose. So he was there as the gosling hatched, and as he walked away, they think, wow, you're really cool. And so they follow this big thing walking away. So they are attracted to the stimulus, and the bigger it was, the more attractive it was to them. Now, this can look kind of absurd. This is an albatross that lays smallish, orangish eggs. But if you put a grapefruit out in the nesting ground, an albatross says, oh my God, what an amazing egg. And they'll love it to death. They just really want to nest on that egg because they're just so attracted to that great, big, shiny thing. They really, really like it. Okay, there's just certain things that organisms seem to be hardwired to like, and they really are attracted to. Let's look at an insect called flower beetle, which you might encounter sometime if you have a stale sack of flour in your cupboard. They're quite small, and they use pheromones to attract mates. These are chemical attractants that travel through the air, pheromones are, and in this case, the male produces a pheromone that attracts females for mating. And in this case, it turns out that the odor that the male produces doesn't indicate anything about his quality. It's just a signal saying, I'm a male, I'm here, and it attracts females, okay? So, males that produce these attractive odors, however, even though they're not any better or worse than the other males, the trait breeds true. So males that have an attractive odor have sons that also produce attractive odors, okay? And females that mate with these attractive males, therefore, if they have sons, their sons will have their dad's attractive traits. So it can happen that there's selection favoring females to prefer even more an attractive trait in males so that they can obtain that attractive trait for their sons. And then when their sons are more successful, the female has more grandchildren. So, to summarize these different female choice hypotheses, females with wealthy mates can produce more offspring, as we saw in crickets and hanging flies. We also have various good genes hypotheses, where that if you wear an ornament, like the lion's mane, it's an honest indicator that, yes, I am tough enough to grow this big, heavy mane, even though I'm living in a hot climate. And if you mate with me, you'll have healthier offspring. Okay, that's a good genes hypothesis. And then third is often referred to as a sexy son hypothesis. So choosy mothers gain more grandchildren through having more attractive sons.